I'm really appreciative for the scientific committee for their invitation to give this talk, and it very much suits the theme of this session when it gets complex. And surgery for delayed upper cervical spine subluxation in kids is fairly complex. No conflict of interest to disclose. So it's not strange to this audience that craniocervical junction has a complex anatomy, particularly in kids, because of many factors. Kids have small bones, anatomic orientation can be difficult with congenital problems, ligamentous abnormalities are more common, and particularly in syndromic, it becomes very, very challenging. And when you go through the literature, there are many published series about pediatrics, atlantoaxial instability. It seems that say there is quite evidence now that safe use of Google harm techniques is considered. Also, there are good results for surgery in terms of rigid fixation. We've learned a lot from the literature by Dr. Menezes, who treated many Down syndrome patients and reported good to excellent surgical outcome with low morbidity with an excellent bone fusion. And even rotatory subluxation, reduction of the rotatory subluxation followed by fusion, either with navigation or without navigation, showed good results. This paper in 2012 was published by the Toronto group at SickKids, who recommended surgery when there is late presentation. Dr. Pang has published a series of articles, and he always recommended traction and considered surgery on delayed presentation. So it seems that delayed presentation has a special place, especially with surgical indication. So we thought to review our data and included all children who had upper cervical subluxation who presented after 1 month from the start of their symptoms, and their surgery had involved the occipital cervical area and were operated during the last 8 years. We had 15 cases, and you could see this table illustrates fairly clearly the indication, the age distribution. Majority were trauma and Down syndrome, but we had also pseudoachondroplasia, mucopolysaccharidosis, neurofibromas, and tumor and juvenile rheumatoid arthritis. So I'm going to go over the cases because I believe that every case of them has a message to explain. This is a 7-year-old male who was involved in motor vehicle collision. Initially, for 3 months, his atlantoaxial subluxation was actually treated in a halo. And then he started developing also a neurologic deficit. So the surgical treatment at that time considered was this wires. However, he failed the wires as well, which I considered, or I learned that wires at this stage of late presentation does not really work. And when he came, he was falling while walking with significant myelopathy. So we considered him for a rigid kind of fixation, and this is the technique we use, which is a carbon fiber Mayfield, and sometimes we use the O-arm either for navigation or to check the accuracy of the screws. So in this case, we achieved a good fusion and a good reduction of C1, C2. We put C1 freehand. C2 was navigated, but you can see the screw on the left side. It was very close to obliterate the neural, foramen transversarium. So even when you have a navigation, you cannot trust it 100%. You have to be fairly careful and do your anatomic calculations and orientation very well. This is a child who is a 4 years who was referred to us after trauma. She had a little torticollis and neck pain, and you can see the increased atlantodental interval, the instability. So this patient we also treated with C1, C2 instrumented fusion, and she improved her neck pain and went on to develop a good outcome. And this, I think the rigid fixation provides you with a good stability that you can rely on. And this 4 months for a follow-up, she's doing fairly well, she's out of the collar. This is an unfortunate six-year-old girl. Unfortunately, she was intubated for a year before she came to us. She was already ventilator dependent. She had some residual movement in her arms. By the time we were able to get her and do her surgery with decompression and fusion, in this case, we thought because of the age and the bone structure, we had to go to the occiput. She improved her arms and legs function while in bed. However, she stayed ventilator dependent, unfortunately. So the later you get to these cases, obviously the worse the outcome. This is a nine-year-old girl that illustrates an example that delay in diagnosis in these cases are fairly common. So she had a repeated chest infection, repeated pneumonia, and by the time pulmonologist referred her to a neurologist who did an MRI that showed atlantoaxial instability and signal change within the spinal cord. She was suspected based on images and facial features and body features to have pseudoachondroplasia, and she also underwent the occipitocervical fusion. We tried to avoid the occiput as much as we could. However, sometimes the bone in these kids and the situation of the quality of the bone forces you to go to the occiput. Now she's able to ambulate and with aborted her attacks of repeated pneumonias. Now this child is a 14-year-old, and here is another lesson I learned, that this patient became ventilator dependent after our surgery. By the time she came to us, she already was not moving her lower limbs. She kept her neck in an extended position, and she had progressive arm weakness. We had a long discussion with the family and with the pulmonology, who actually thought preoperatively that she could be ventilator dependent from her musculoskeletal involvement from the disease. However, we thought to give a chance. We did a tracheostomy electively before surgery. We did an occipitocervical fusion. She stayed in the ICU, weaned twice, however, failed weaning and had to, and right now she is ventilator dependent, unfortunately. Now we'll move on to Down syndrome, where I'll present five cases of Down syndrome that came, many of them, with neurological deficit. This is a 10-year-old child who has been roaming around with neurologic deficit, progressive weakness and inability to walk steady. You can see reflection extension. So we did this patient in a front and back approach where we intubated nasally under neuromonitoring. We applied intraoperative traction. We corrected using a Casper pins. Then we did a front and then a back. And then she went on to develop very good fusion. And she improved. She was able to walk, yet she had some residual weakness in her hands. This is an 11-year-old Down syndrome who presented also with progressive myelopathy at a different center. This child had frequent falling, initially was treated in wires connected to the spine with an occipital screws. However, the fixation failed, so we collaborated and we did an occipitocervical more rigid fixation. The child was able to walk again. This is a Down syndrome. Now, in this child, I was involved earlier, and we aimed to reduce the patient and do instrumented fusion from the beginning. We did a C1 to C3 fusion, and if you look at the C1 screws, these are not pretty screws. And when I reviewed the case again, the midline correction was excellent on CT scan. However, the screw was directed upwards, and I started reviewing the anatomy of the lateral mass in Down syndrome, and I find many of them are trapezoid in shape. The distance below the arch that you can insert a screw sometimes is smaller than the size of the screw that you can insert. So instead of aiming straight parallel to the arch, now I try as much as I could to aim upwards in order to avoid that screw purchase. So we were lucky that the fixation was holding, and the patient also did well. This is a Down syndrome as well, presented late after progressive decline in upper and lower limb function, was not walking. Now, this child, we did C1 to C2 fusion after traction. Traction always helps, even in Down syndrome in young age. However, we got a good reduction, but after 6 weeks, neurologically worse again. So why is that? I think because of two things. The bone is weak, and the other thing, I noticed that her mother was carrying her from bed by lifting her head up from the occiput. And that was also part of the problem, and I did not put the patient in a halo, she was only in a collar. I put her in traction again, I did occipital cervical fusion, we were lucky again, she was able to move her arms and quite happy. This is an 11-year-old girl, now we learned the lessons, so we reduced her and we did C1, C2 fusion in the way we learned. However, we learned a new lesson here. I did the C1 freehand, I did an intraoperative O-arm, and look at the right C1 screw. It was not purchasing the lateral mass. So intraoperatively, we decided to correct it and do the correct purchase, and we're lucky that she's now good enough, and I put her in a halo, and she's tolerating it so far. This is a neurofibromatosis case that was operated for this high cervical intraspinal lesion. She developed CSF leak that we corrected. However, with follow-up, these cases need to be followed up for a long time. She developed upper cervical kyphosis. So we decided to do a C1 to C3 fusion using navigation, using transarticular screw, and we're able to correct the overall spinal alignment. This is an intramedullary tumor, so this is was a very challenging case because the age of the patient, 2 years old, even before the C1 completes its development, it was subluxed. So I collaborated with a pediatric neurosurgeon who resected the pilocytic astrocytoma that was intramedullary. And in these cases, sometimes you put wires, you put screws, you put whatever that works in order to hold your instruments. I think she did reasonably well. In rotatory subluxation, even if they present late, don't hesitate to reduce them using traction because they fairly reduce and you're able to get a good alignment and a good fixation. Even when they are developing neurologic deficit, sometimes their deficit will improve in bed while you are putting them in traction. In conclusion, the clinical outcome that we learned from our cases, we had no mortality, no motor power worsening, respiratory function, obviously if they present late and fairly advanced in their disease does not improve, you need to pay attention to those with mucopolysaccharidosis cases or their neuromuscular system is fairly involved. Caution with occipital cervical fusion in patient positioning in the OR and even extubation after surgery. One patient was prematurely extubated, she had to be reintubated while she is in PICU. Occipital cervical fusion, we have seen more in my cases, more going to the occiput, probably because of delayed presentation, weak bones, but as much as I could, I would only approach C1, C2. I think I'll put them more in a halo. When you do navigation, you have to be very careful because navigation can be off by 1 or 2 millimeters, and sometimes this is how much you need to go wrong. We did an article studying C1, C2, C1 screw, because if you look here, look at the transverse measurement of the foramen, and it's almost as equal as the lateral mass. So, and the curvature of the medial edge of the lateral mass does not help you very much to define an anatomic border. So nowadays we rely on the medial border of the arch. We feel the medial border of the lateral mass, and then we go 1 or 2 millimeters lateral, and then we insert the screw and we use a tap. And this was published as a technical note. The screw fixation provides a good stability, particularly when the wires fail. Nowadays, I don't go for wires. Sometimes I would supplement with wires, but I will primarily depend on screw fixation. C1, C2, rotatory subluxation, they respond fairly well to traction, even in delayed fashion. I repeated my token on neuro navigation. Sometimes I put small fiducial screws to double check my accuracy and re-register my navigation if I think I'm off. Following occipital cervical fusion in kids, what happens to the alignment and what happens to the growth of the child? The alignment in our series was actually better in the majority of cases. It was published repeatedly that the alignment is better and is not affected, and the majority of cases, even their growth is not affected. I would like to thank the organizing committee and the scientific committee for giving me this chance. I would like to thank everyone who worked on the success of our team. This is a collaborative effort. Resident nurses, I would like to thank the people who invited me to share their experience in their cases.